Imagine two options. One with a 75% chance of winning, and another with a 25% chance of winning. And your job is to win. If you pick the option with a 75% chance of winning and you actually lose, did you pick right or did you pick wrong? Hopefully that made you pause and think for a second.
Well, it should.
Today we're going to be talking about learning in bets, making smarter decisions when you don't have all the facts by Annie Duke. Here are my top three learnings from the book. Learning number one, we need to decouple the quality of our decision making with the quality of our outcomes. Learning number two, the quality of our lives is the sum of the quality of our decisions plus luck. This makes learning from our past decisions really hard for many reasons. And learning number three, all decisions are bets. By acknowledging this, we can learn. None of this might make sense right now, but that's okay. Let us get started. Decouple the quality of our decision making with the quality of our outcome. What does that even mean? To be honest, this was the most practical and helpful takeaway for me personally. So imagine a coin toss with a 50-50 odds. Ask the wager, which side will the coin land on? What happens if the odds were different? What happens if for, let's say, heads, there's a 75% chance of it landing on heads and a 25% chance that it will land on tails? Which one would you wager on now? If you pick the option of it landing on heads because there's a 75% chance of it landing on there, and you actually lost and it lands on tails, did you pick the right decision or did you pick the wrong decision? Should you have picked the option with a 25% chance of winning instead of a 75% chance of winning? Probably not, right? That's why it's important to decouple the quality of our decision making with the quality of our outcome. Choosing a 75% chance of winning over a 25% chance of winning is a quality decision at the moment with the information that you were given. If you chose a 25% chance of winning instead of the 75%, that would have been a bad decision. In this case, the coin actually landing on tails is a bad outcome that was based on a good quality decision that you made. Here, Duke describes the situation that happens when she was providing running commentary at a charity poker event. She writes, "At one such tournament, I told the audience that one player would win 76% of the time and the other would win 24% of the time. I dealt the remaining cards, the last of which turned the 24% hand into the winner. Amid the cheers and groans, someone in the audience called out, 'Annie, you were wrong.' In the same spirit he said it, I explained I wasn't. I said that it would happen 24% of the time. That's not zero. You got to see the 24%. A few hands later, almost the same thing happened. Two players put all their chips in the pot and they turned their cards face up. One player was 18% to win and the other was 82% to win the hand. Again, the player with the worst hand, when they put their chips in, hit a sequential lucky card to win the pot. This time, the same guy in the crowd called out, 'Look, it was 18%. In that aha moment, he changed his definition of what it meant to be wrong. When we think in advance about the chances of alternative outcomes and make a decision based on those chances, it doesn't automatically make us wrong when things don't work out. It just means that one event in a possible set of futures occurred." This is a mindset shift for me. Acknowledging that the outcomes of our decision is truly probabilistic makes us redefine success and redefine failure. What is right and what is wrong? I mean, imagine this scenario. We did all that we could and we increased the odds of our success to 99%. There's still a 1% chance of failure. What happens if that 1% chance of failure actually happened? Were we wrong? Did we not do a good job? I mean, what I took away from here is that just because the outcome of what we desired did not happen does not mean that our thought process or our decision-making process was wrong. What it actually means is that the outcome was not what we desired. I think this is a breakthrough moment for me for some reason. Duke explains that generally people have a tendency to equate the quality of our decision-making with the quality of our outcome. In poker, people call this resulting. I think it's an interesting exercise to think back in our lives and see if resulting was a common theme in our thought process. I don't know about everyone else watching here, but unfortunately for myself, resulting happens a lot in my life. I think I feel reliant on the correlation between my decision making and the quality of my outcome to understand if my decision making was sound. If there was a shitty outcome, I automatically think to myself, okay, was my decision quality bad? Could I have done something differently? Could I have made a different decision? And if my outcome was good, I guess I don't think much about it. And maybe I should reflect a little bit. But resulting can't be all bad, right? I mean, don't we want to learn so that we don't make the same bad mistakes again and again? This leads to my second learning. The quality of our lives is the sum of the quality of our decision-making plus luck. This makes learning from our past decisions really hard. If we accept that there is an imperfect relationship between the quality of our decisions and the quality of our outcomes, how do we actually gauge the quality of our decision-making? Duke agrees that we actually need to learn from the quality of our outcomes, which points out that this is possible but really hard, and for many reasons. In order to learn from our outcomes, we really need to field our outcomes, our results, into two categories, luck or skill. This sounds easy, right? We just need to sort our experiences into luck or skill. Well, it's not. Apparently, we're super prone into making fielding errors, which means we sort things that should be luck into skill and vice versa. Some of the common reasons why we make fielding errors are, one, it's not always luck or skill. It could be luck and skill. Reason number two, habitual self-serving bias makes us easy to attribute our outcomes incorrectly. And reason number three, motivated reasoning makes us really hard to avoid habitual self-serving bias. What does that all mean? Well, let us focus on one at a time. Reason number one, it's not always luck or skill, it's luck and skill. Fielding our outcomes into either luck or skill seems simple, but typically it's not that clear. This is because a lot of our outcomes are actually due to a combination of luck and skill. This makes working backwards to determine if this is an experience we can learn from to be really hard. Duke provides the following examples. An outcome like losing weight could be the direct result of a change in diet or increased exercise skill, or a sudden change in our metabolism or a famine luck. We can get in a car crash because we didn't stop at the red light skill, or because another driver ran a red light luck. A student could do poorly on a test because they didn't study skill, or because the teacher was mean luck. Most of the outcomes in our lives are unfortunately due to both skill and luck. In addition to the fact that our outcomes are never just due to luck or skill, we are habituated in certain ways that make it hard for us to rationalize which part is due to luck and which part is due to skill. According to Duke, studies have shown that when we have a good outcome, it cues the routines of crediting the result to our awesome decision-making, delivering the rewards of a positive update to our self-narrative, aka when there's a good outcome, we feel good about ourselves. When we have a bad outcome, it cues the routines of offloading responsibility for the results, delivering the reward of avoiding a negative self-narrative update. AKA, when we have a bad outcome, it's not our fault. Interestingly, with the same cues, we actually flip the routine for our peers, but the reward is the same, feeling good about ourselves. Habitual self-serving bias is problematic in many ways and makes it really hard for learning. Duke writes, self-serving bias has immediate and obvious consequences for our ability to learn from experience. Blaming the bulk of our bad outcomes on luck means we miss opportunities to examine our decision to see where we could do better. Taking credit for the good stuff means we'll often reinforce decisions that shouldn't be reinforced and then miss opportunities to see where we could have done better. To be sure, some of the bad stuff that happens is mainly due to luck, and some of the good stuff that happens is mainly due to skill. I just know that that is not true all the time. 100% of our bad outcomes aren't because we got unlucky, and 100% of our good outcomes aren't because we're so awesome. Yet, this is how we process the future as it unfolds. To make things actually worse, we're actually not equipped well to deal with habitual self-serving bias. Funny enough, the smarter we are, the harder it will be for us. Duke writes, the popular wisdom is that the smarter you are, the less susceptible you are to fake news or disinformation. After all, smart people are more likely to analyze and effectively evaluate where the information is coming from, right? Part of being smart is being good at processing information, parsing the quality of an argument, and the credibility of the source. So intuitively, it feels like smart people should have the ability to spot motivated reasoning coming and should have more intellectual resources to fight it. Surprisingly, being smart can actually make bias worse. Let me give you a different intuitive frame. The smarter you are, the better you are at constructing a narrative that supports your belief, rationalizing and framing the data to fit your argument or point of view. After all, people in the spin room in a political setting are generally pretty smart for a reason. Well, all that's unfortunate news. So essentially, to summarize, to learn from our outcomes, we need to sort correctly whether or not the outcome is due to the quality of our decision making or luck. Sadly, sorting is hard because it's not always luck or skill, it's luck and skill. And in addition, it's hard because habitual self-serving bias increases the difficulty for us to sort correctly. to make things worse, the smarter we are, the more likely we're unable to avoid these problems. So that sucks. Good thing Annie Duke provides us with some suggestions to overcome this. And this moves us to our third learning. Life is a game of imperfect information, so bet to learn. Whether or not we like it or not, we don't live in an orderly world where randomness is not wreak havoc and things are perfectly predictable. We live in a world where there's a lot of things that are outside of our control. And as a result, our life is not just impacted by our own abilities or things that we can control. It's impacted by random chance and therefore luck. Life is full of uncertainty and unknown, and as such, Duke finds that our life is less like chess and more like poker. She writes, "Chess contains no hidden information and very little luck. The pieces are all there for both players to see. Pieces can't randomly appear or disappear from the board or get moved from one position to another by chance. No one rolls the dice, after which, if the roll goes against you, your bishop is taken off the board. If you lose at a game of chess, it must be because there were better moves you didn't make or didn't see. Poker, in contrast, is a game of incomplete information. It is a game of decision-making under conditions of uncertainty over time. Not coincidentally, that is a close to the definition of game theory. Valuable information remains hidden. There's also an element of luck in any outcome. You could make the best possible decision at every point and still lose a hand, because you don't know what new cards will be dealt and revealed. Once the game is finished and you try to learn from the results, separating the quality of your decisions from the influence luck is difficult. In chess, outcomes correlate more tightly with decision quality. In poker, it's much easier to get lucky and win, or get unlucky and lose. If life were like chess, nearly every single time you ran a red light, you would get into an accident, or at least receive a ticket. In a world where it's hard to even have complete information to make our decisions, where it's hard for us to even learn from the outcomes to see if our decisions are good, how do we get better? How do we overcome the imperfect circumstances around us and actually grow? I would categorize Duke's suggestions into three main concepts. Concept number one, we need to put effort in understanding our own bad habits and patterns. Concept number two, we need to build intentional good habits to inspire constant improvements. And concept number three, we need to build a support system that helps us see our bad habits when we can't see it ourselves. All these three things together will increase our chance of learning from our outcomes. To find a solution to a problem, we actually need to understand the problem in the first place. And to understand how to make less bad decisions, we kind of need to understand the systematic problems that get in our way. These bad habits include some of the things that we talked about earlier, like habitual self-serving bias, motivated reasoning, but it could also include more concepts like hindsight bias or even our belief formation process. Despite what we like to think, our belief formation process actually looks kind of like this. One, experience it. Two, believe that it is true. And three, maybe question it later. It's actually kind of a little scary. But really, acknowledging the problem in the first place, we can actually start finding, perhaps building positive habits that allowed us to avoid these problems in the first place. Potential habit to calibrate our belief formation system could be asking ourselves the question, do you want to bet? Instead of asking ourselves, what should I do? Perhaps you can make a habit of asking yourselves, am I willing to take this bet? Imagine a scenario where you were asked about your childhood best friend, what their favorite color was, and you haven't seen this person in, I don't know, 20 years. You might find yourself casually answering, I don't know, blue? What happened if you were challenged? What happened if someone said, you want to bet on that? Do you find yourself taking a pause? What do I actually know? This is a benefit of actually thinking in bets. Using thinking in bets as a tool to help us recalibrate and remember the things that we know and to pause for a second and think. Duke writes, when we treat outcomes fielding as a bet, it pushes us to feel outcomes more objectively into the appropriate buckets because that is how bets are won. Winning feels good. Winning is a positive update to our personal narrative. Winning is a reward. With enough practice, reinforced by the reward of feeling good about ourselves, thinking of fielding outcomes as bets will become a habit of mind. Thinking in bets trigger a more open-minded exploration of alternative hypotheses, of reason-supported conclusions opposite to the routine of self-serving bias. We're more likely to explore the opposite side of an argument more often, more seriously, and that will move us closer to the truth of the matter. Thinking in bets also triggers perspective taking, leveraging the difference between how we field our own outcomes versus other outcomes to get closer to the objective truth. Thinking in bets will help us internalize the belief that all decisions are bets, and therefore is an amazing, effective belief calibrator. Another interesting habit I felt like Duke suggested in her book is acknowledging tilt and preparing a pre-committed response. Tilt is the poker player's worst enemy. The word instantly communicates to other poker players that you're emotionally unhinged in your decision-making because of the ways things turned out. If you blow some recent event out of proportion and react in a drastic way, you are on tilt. There are emotional and psychological signs of tilt. In poker, you can hear a poker player on tilt from several tables away. Tilt, of course, is not limited to poker. Any kind of outcome has the potential for causing an emotional reaction. We can be tempted to make a reactive emotional decision in a disagreement with a relationship partner, or because of bad service in a restaurant, or a comment in the workplace, or making a sale only to have it canceled, or having an idea dismissed. We have all had this experience in our personal and professional lives, blowing out of proportion a momentary event because of an in-the-moment emotional reaction. I never heard of the word tilt until this book, but I've definitely experienced tilt many, many times. I think for me, signs of me experiencing tilt could be rolling my eyes or interrupting others, in frustration when they're speaking, or I mean just not speaking at all due to anger or raising my voice. I think that I need to recognize that these are kind of my signs that I'm experiencing tilt, and I really need to kind of come up with a pre-committed response to these situations. And maybe that pre-committed response is really just to take a pause and recalibrate and reevaluate the situation. Anyway, that leads us to our third and final habit that I'm going to cover in this book. I find this one actually really interesting. Yeah, I've been using this one very often. So another suggestion that Duke has is that we should start expressing our beliefs on a scale. So what does that mean? So instead of saying, I am confident in X, you can start saying, I am 85% confident in X. So there's many benefits to doing this, right? The first benefit could be that you give your listener a more realistic understanding of how confident you are so that they can make better decisions. And the second is that it kind of forces a conscious calibration on your own side. Am I actually 85% confident or actually 25% confident? I think that by being forced to express things on kind of a scale, you have to do that recalibration. And if you can't express things on a percentage, perhaps the right answer is to say, I'm not sure, which is a completely acceptable answer. I've actually been using this a lot at work, and I really think it's helped me kind of calibrate my own understanding of situations and to make better decisions, and hopefully help my peers make better decisions as well based on what I told them. To summarize, three habits for you to consider adding to your routine could be 1, thinking in bets, 2, acknowledging tilt and preparing a pre-committed response, and 3, expressing your confidence on a scale. There was actually another really big point in Duke's book, which is about building a support system to help you actually notice and find your bad habits and patterns when you can't actually find them yourself. She calls this a truth-seeking group. She goes into a lot of details on this, how it should be done, what are the elements that you're looking for, etc. I'm actually not going to cover it here, but if you want to read more or figure this out, you should read the book. It's actually really good and something I've been trying to think more about, but I think I would be able to cover that topic well in a book review. So read about it. Well, that's all I got. I hope I did a good job covering some of the more interesting things I found in this book. I mean, this book was just filled with great examples and interesting research and just really definitely worth the read. And to be completely honest, I feel super grateful that I have read this book. It's really influenced kind of my life, especially at work. In particular, I feel like the concept of like decoupling our decision-making process and our outcomes just be really meaningful for me. As a product manager, I feel a lot of responsibility in making sure that I make good decisions at work, because I feel like my decisions as a product manager influences a lot of people and influences the company at a large scale. And just having more clarity in analyzing the quality of my decisions and understanding and sorting my outcomes has just made a huge influence on how I think about things, how I do retrospectives, and etc. And this book, this book actually took me like 3 months to write, and I think it's because it's just so dense with such great information. I think I listened to the audiobook twice. I like read it 3 times in the last 3 months. It's just an amazing book. So I hope you all have an opportunity to read it and enjoy this book review. And yeah, I went on a little bit of a rant there, didn't I? Anyway, I hope you all enjoyed this book review, and if you want to hear more about it, feel free to subscribe. All right, thank you so much, and I hope you had a great time. Bye-bye.